the cross candle.
Christ is the light of the world.
Good morning and welcome to week 8 of lockdown. After I thought last week was 6 and Paul told me it was 7, so welcome to week 8. We've had some slight restrictions lifted around the country, so I hope that you've had the opportunity to meet up with some friends or family or just get out of the house and stretch your legs. In preparing for this week, I have looked at Romans chapter 16 and just wanted to share a small reading about it. Romans chapter 16 is a wonderful reminder of the richness of the Christian community. It's a wonderful insight into Paul's commitment to people as individuals. The missionary journey of Paul and his letters dominate our New Testament, but these verses reveal Paul as a team player who deeply appreciated other believers. The names are a mix of Greek, Latin, and Jewish. They invite us to rejoice in the diversity of the family of faith. There are men and women, slaves and freedmen, singles and married. Paul is thankful for them all and acknowledges their individual commitment to the Lord Jesus, to his people, and to himself personally. As well as greeting 26 people by name, Paul sends greetings from 8 people who were with him at the time of the writing. It's a great example of how to value the believers who come into our lives. Perhaps this will give you the opportunity to pause and consider the contribution that others have made to your life. Some may be relatives who have offered love and support over long years and through difficult circumstances. Others may be people who you've met along the way, who have brought an awareness of God into your life. Still others may be personal friends who encourage you in your walk with the Lord, and others may have been teachers and guides in your understanding of the scriptures. Give thanks for them today. All are gifts from a gracious, loving, and caring Father. One way that we can celebrate those connections and those relationships is possibly meet in small groups with these people, maybe in a local cafe or restaurant. Share the love of Christ together, share your knowledge, and give thanks for each other and indeed for our loving Lord. We're going to open this morning with Be Thou My Vision. Right, for this week's
my vision, O Lord of my heart, not be all else to me save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night, waking or sleeping, thy presence my light. I need not, nor man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance now and always. Thou and thou only, first in my heart. My King of heaven, my treasure. My victory won, may I reach heaven's joys, bright heaven's sun. Heart of my own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O of all. will be my vision, O ruler of all.
Vision. Right, for this week's notices, we're still waiting to hear what the government's going to do, if they are going to ease up some of the restrictions. And if they do lift the numbers higher than 10, we may be able to meet together, back together in the church. But obviously this week and probably next week as well, we'll still be doing the online format. So that's about it for the notices that we've got. But here we have Elizabeth to do our birthdays. Okay,
happy birthday to Carrie Hewitt, David McDougall, Hazel Thompson, and Paul Markcroft.
Okay, now time to everyone to get on their feet, stretch their arms and legs. I'm sure you know the actions, and if you don't, play it twice so you can learn them. Let's all join together for John 3:16. By Selwyn to lead us in today's prayer.
All right, good morning, folks. It's good to be back together again. How are your bubbles going? It's good to be able to get out a little bit. We actually enjoyed a meal of fish and chips on Saturday night, which is something we've been looking forward to for a few days. Now, for those of you who are using the word for today, unfortunately, they haven't come this month. But you can get on if you have access to the net. Just put in word for today, and when it comes up, go to where it says word for today, Rima. If you click on that, you'll get the word for today readings each day. So shall we have a time of prayer together? Let us pray. Our God, how great is your faithfulness. Because of your faithfulness, you have brought us together this morning to worship you. We thank you that we can say, great is your faithfulness, O God, our Father. We thank you that you want to have a relationship with us. You want to be in every part of our lives, and yet so often we leave you out. We have not always acknowledged you. We have not always been the people you want us to be. We confess our shortcomings and ask your forgiveness. You have promised that as far as the east is from the west, so far have you set our sin from us. You call us to give thanks and to pray for others. We pray for all who care for the sick, particularly at this time. We remember the doctors and the nurses caring for those with the virus. Many have put their lives on the line. We pray that as they treat their patients, they may be kept safe from any infection. Many have left their families to live in isolation so that they can care for their patients. We pray for all who have lost their jobs or businesses. Be with them that they may see that there is yet a way ahead. We pray for all families who have been changed because of the virus. As we move into level 2 and they can reunite, keep them safe and may they rejoice at time together again in whatever restrictions there may be. We pray for all world leaders that they may set aside their differences of power and ambition to bring about the end of this terrible virus consuming the world and work together to find a vaccine. As the scripture says, may they beat their swords into plough shields. We thank you for the work of our government and the work they have done to bring us into level 2. May we continue to observe what they asked us to do, that our country may recover and those who have lost employment be able to return to work and support their families. Give to them and their employers a confidence for the future. We pray for those of our congregation who are not well. Many have worshipped with us, but time is now difficult for them. Surround them with your love and presence, that they may know that they are not forgotten. We thank you for modern technology to communicate the gospel and with each other, for this live stream so that we can be together in this way and still feel part of your church here at St. Andrew's and the whole world. We remember Steve and Stephen as they work with us at this time. We thank you for them and their encouragement and their guidance. Guide us as we continue to seek a new minister as things are starting to look encouraging. We thank you for Paul and his team who week by week put together these services. There are some who are unable to get this live stream because they have no computer or no known link. Keep them faithful that they may know the assurance of your love and your blessings for them. Be with Christina and she brings this message this morning. Fill her with your spirit and may the words she shares be your words for us today. Help us to have ears to hear and hearts to obey. We thank you, Lord. We bring these prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, who has promised that whatsoever we ask, believing, you will grant us. Have a great day and enjoy the next week. Thank you.
Thank you.
We're going to have two songs together now. First one, In Christ Alone. And then for our younger ones who like that upbeat, and for those that are a little bit older and still like the upbeat, we have 10,000 Reasons.
hope is firm. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I lay. Light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me,
Reading is brought to us by Jesse. It's from the book of Ephesians.
No.
This reading comes from Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 to 10.
As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath, but because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved, and God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do.
No. Today's message is brought to us by Christina, and it's continuation from Marcel's message last week. So if you missed that, jump onto last week's YouTube video, watch Marcel's message, and we have the second part of the generous landowner this morning.
Good morning. It's lovely to be sharing with you again, and I know that there may be some disappointment as we also here feel a bit of disappointment that we're not yet meeting together, but we're still going on with our remote church. However, the time will come, and we just need to keep trusting and keep looking after one another and know that soon we will be able to meet together in person. However, we're very grateful, and I'm very grateful for the technology that allows us to do our services this way, so we don't miss out completely. So it's my job to preach this morning, and I think we'll just start with a short prayer. Lord God, thank you for all the goodness that you have poured out upon us. Thank you for your word and all the riches that are to be found in your word. And I pray as we share this message this morning that you will give us all ears to hear. Give us minds to understand. Give us hearts to receive. And give us the will to act according to your purposes in our lives. In the name of Jesus. Amen. So as you probably are aware, we've been spending the last few weeks just going into aspects of grace, the grace of God, and how his grace works in the world and in our lives. And you may recall that last week, Marcel shared with us on the parable of the generous landowner. So I'm going to sort of develop a little bit more around about that parable. So I thought I would just start off by reminding ourselves of the parable. You'll remember that the landowner went out to find people to work in his vineyard, and he went out at different times of the day. And when he went to pay the workers, those who were paid last, or those who worked only for an hour, they were hired last, were paid first, and they were paid exactly the same pay as those who worked the whole day. And so Marcel was asking the question, is this fair? And I think he put it very, very beautifully when he said, no, it's not fair, but it is grace. And there's a great deal of difference between grace and fairness. So let's just put that parable into a modern context. I want you to imagine that you are a person who's looking desperately for work. You badly need to earn some money. And so you head down to a local business that you're aware of, Grace Industries. You've heard that they are good employers and that they may be hiring people. So you talk to the personnel officer there and you're told, yes, we would love to employ you, but we only have one position open at the moment. It's just as a cleaner, we just need a cleaner, but if you're willing to take the job, it's yours. Yep, you say, fine, I'm desperate, I'm overqualified, but I will take that job. And so you start work as a cleaner and you work very hard, vacuuming carpets, emptying bins, cleaning toilets, washing floors. And finally, you receive your first payslip. You look at your payslip and then you take a second look. There must be a mistake, you say. But no, says the pay clerk, that's correct. But that's far more than a cleaner is worth, you say. Are you sure? Well, if that's what the cleaner gets, I wonder what you pay the CEO. Well, as it happens, says the personnel officer who just entered the room, there's a note on your file that the CEO position has become available and we'd like to offer it to you. Would you like the job? Are you kidding, you say? Of course I do. Great, you're told. You start tomorrow. And so you start work as the CEO of the business and you work hard creating budgets, calling suppliers, having meetings, monitoring cash flows. And finally, you receive your payslip. You have a look at the payslip. And then you take a second look. Hold on, you say. There must be some mistake here. No, says the pay clerk, that's correct. But you reply, that's exactly what I got as a cleaner. Listen, I've been creating budgets, calling suppliers, having meetings, monitoring cash flows. I'm an important and hardworking person. Surely the CEO is worth more than a mere cleaner. Oh, no, says the personnel officer who's just entered the room. You see, Mr. Christ, who's the owner of Grace Industries, he doesn't work on the same principles as the rest of the world. He doesn't pay us on the basis of what we've done. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. Many would say that in this story and also in the story, Jesus' parable of the generous landowner, that there is an inherent unfairness in the story. If you identify with the workers who were hired last, or indeed with the cleaner, you might say that they are treated with extraordinary generosity. However, if you identify with those who were hired first, or with the CEO of the business, then you'd be crying foul. We place arbitrary value on different types of work or different types of performance. And so many might have the question, does God have the right? Does God have the right to act graciously, even if it seems unfair? And I suppose that the short answer would be yes. If you believe that God is the creator of all things that exist and is the Lord of all things, including you and me, then of course he has every right to do as he sees fit, no matter what that is or how it might affect anyone. I know it sounds really harsh, but I'm reminded of the person in the Bible where it says, does the clay have the right to complain to the potter that it's been made into a particular item and not into something else? So Jesus was primarily concerned that people understand what God's kingdom is all about, that God's kingdom is radically different from that which is normal and fair and acceptable in the world. We have a mentality of deserving, don't we? Or at least I suppose that I do, and I guess that many do. When you think about the films that we see, the books that we read, especially the stories, the fiction, it usually turns out that the bad guy gets caught in the end and the good person gets vindicated and goes on to live a happy and wonderful life. We believe that in an ideal world, you deserve what you get, and you get what you deserve. But we have to remember that God actually owes us nothing. God is not obligated to us. We are obligated to Him. We can't give Him anything that is not already His. Everything we are, everything we have, came from God and is a gift from Him. Now, God does set rules for us to live by, but He doesn't set them because He needs us to obey those laws or rules. He gives us those rules because they are good for us. They're for our good and for the good of our community and our society. I want us to think about an example from life. We all obey the law. Some of us obey the law more rigorously than others, but we all obey the law. However, we don't expect any extraordinary reward for obeying the law. We don't have a high court judge knocking on our door and saying, "Thank you very much for not murdering or stealing or cheating anybody this week." That would be ridiculous. We obey the law because that is what we do as good citizens and because we know it is for our good and for the good of our society. And so also, the rules that God has given us to live by are for our good and for the good of our society. But His grace to us, expressed through His love and through the blessings that He gives us, that grace is not dependent on our obeying the rules. If it was, we could earn our way to heaven. And if we could earn our way to heaven, then Christ's death on the cross would be meaningless and God's grace would be worthless. But that's not how God works. God's abundant blessings come to us not according to what we deserve. But He has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of His own purpose and grace. And this grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time. Now think about that. He'd already decided to give us His grace before we had even been created, before we had the chance to do anything good or bad. It had been given in Christ Jesus. The Christian life is primarily a life of grace. No one gets what they deserve. The thief on the cross who begged Jesus with almost his dying breath, receives the same reward of eternal life as the person who has served Christ faithfully for all of their life. Because God's promises are not dependent on any of us who receive from him, but the fulfillment of his promises is wholly dependent on the merits of Christ. And isn't that good news? Isn't that wonderful news? It's the merits of Christ that fulfills God's promises to us, and it's through Christ that we receive his blessings. Put simply, grace is God's riches at Christ's expense. So finally, I'd just like to go back to my earlier statement when I said God can do whatever he likes, regardless of the consequences for anyone. And that is a harsh statement, or it would be harsh if God was not God. Remember who God is. God is love. He acts in love, and he is filled with love. I came across a quote just this week, which I'd like to share with you, because it somehow shows the great depth and eternity of God's love. And this is a quote from Julian of Norwich. So I was taught that love is our Lord's meaning. And I saw very certainly in this and in everything that before God made us, God loved us, which love was never abated and never will be. And in this love, God made all things profitable to us. And in this love, our life is everlasting. In this love, we have our beginning. And all this shall we see in God without end. We can be confident in God because he is love. All his goodness to us is dependent only on his eternal and sacrificial and completed work in Christ. His goodness to us is not dependent on our goodness, but on the goodness of Christ. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. We cannot compare ourselves one with another. We all fall short. But God has given us his grace as a gift through Jesus. Let's receive it and be thankful. Amen.
Our final song this morning is Only by Grace.
Can we enter?
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forever. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.
Okay, we're rolling now, Selwyn, so if you want to lead us now, that'll be great.
You tell me when you're ready.
Yep, we're all go.
All go. Would you believe it? What? We'll get there.
Yeah.
Okay.